To another episode of Discovering the Truth with Dan Duvall. I'm so excited that you're with us. And I'm so excited about what we are endeavoring to get into this month. The entire month of April here on Discovering the Truth with Dan Duvall, we're going to be focusing on the issue of wounded by leadership. Now, this is based on one of my books. Now, I've published two books. One is called Wounded by Leadership, and the other is called Noah's Ark and the End of Days. Now, Noah's Ark and the End of Days really dives into my interests and the way the Lord has led me to understand a lot of things concerning the last days, the end times, what we're looking towards, and definitely a direction of ministry that I am greatly, greatly drawn to and I believe is relevant for today. But my testimony of walking out the things that God has called me to walk out has resulted in a lot of wounding and injury in my own personal life that the Lord has had to coach me through. Hence, when I came around to writing a second book, I really felt strongly that this issue of being wounded by spiritual leadership needed to be addressed. Hence the book, Wounded by Leadership. So we're spending a whole month talking about the issue. Before we dive in, I just want to get some business out of the way. One, we have a new website up. It's discoveringthetruthwithdanduvall.com. We used to be discoveringthetruthwithdanduvall.tk for those of you that wanted to or want to go and watch the live footage where you can actually see me on the camera if you listen to this through Blog Talk or podcast on iTunes. On Tuesdays at 7 o'clock p.m., we go live for 2 hours. And at www.discoveringthetruthwithdanduvall.com, you can go watch the program live. Sometimes even my guests are live on camera like we had last week. And you also find a chat room there. Obviously, for those of you that are in Blog Talk, we also have a chat room available there as well. So just be aware of that change. Also, Bride Ministries is a nonprofit organization. We want to do a lot of things. I have vision to build a media studio. I have vision to expand this radio broadcast. I have vision to promote unity in the body of Christ. We are supporting overseas missions right now. There's a lot of things that are on the agenda. And if you feel that this show or any of our other materials, books, audio files, and so forth on our website have been a blessing to you, please partner with us to put the message out and to build the things which God has called us to build. Also, I want this to be a forum. In other words, this month, we're cracking into a topic that is so, so relevant to everything that people are experiencing today. It's almost pandemic. The number of Christians that I meet that have come out of or are presently in situations where they are being injured, taking injury from their spiritual leadership, it's just simply overwhelming. I want this to be a forum. I want to hear you talk about it. I'm going to be talking about it. And you know, my plan with this program, so forth, we're going to be clarifying the issue. We're going to be giving biblical teaching on the issue. We're going to be providing tools to help you, your friends, your family members, people that you know that are hurting, overcome. That's our goal. We want to be a tool in your hand in order to allow you to receive from God what He has for you instead of being stuck in a rut that you may have found yourself in as a result of things that have happened because of leadership. But I reiterate, and I'm going to reiterate again, we want to hear you. I want to hear you. I want to talk to you. What's your story? The call-in number is 718-766-4160. That's 718-766-4160. Use it. Weigh in on the discussion. Let's talk about this thing, because it's happening. There's no question that it's happening. Let's start talking about it. One, so that we can find the healing that we need. And two, so that we can identify those things which are being done that need to be changed. Bring awareness. Bring awareness. You know, sometimes people are doing things, they don't even know what they're doing. One of the lessons we'll be talking about is Moses, one of the greatest leaders in the Bible. In the beginning, he didn't really know what he was doing. He was hurting people and himself. We want to bring awareness, and we want to bring clarity, and we want to bring healing. And so we're going to be talking about Wounded by Leadership. We want to hear you. Now, when it comes to the area of Wounded by Leadership, here's the deal. Most of the materials that have been produced, created, put forth, deal with two areas. They deal with this. Either empowering leaders to be better leaders, which is great. Or they are rebuking people that are in rebellion and self-destructive activities. Rebellion is a very real issue. And there are a lot of people that might say they've been wounded by leadership, but really, well, it's their own fault for being so rebellious and hard-headed. They don't listen to anybody, and they're hurting themselves and others. Now, most of the work that has been done in the area of dealing with leadership is in these two camps, either empowering leaders, and there's been a lot of great, great works done in this area. I mean, you know, John Maxwell. I know I read a great book by Miles Monroe dealing with leadership. You know, there's a lot of books that have been put forth. And empowering leadership is something that's necessary, because what does the world need today? The world needs leaders. Why? Because as the world is spiraling into the last days and all of these things are going on, strong, God-given, God-appointed, God-anointed leadership is going to need to stand up and lead people in difficult situations during difficult times. God needs to release leaders. And so they need to be empowered. And this is good. But there's this other side, which I have found has been thoroughly, thoroughly overlooked. What is this side? What is this side? What about those that have done everything in their power to do the right thing? They've done everything in their power to do the right thing, and yet they've been wounded by leadership. They've found themselves in circumstances that were unfair, not right, discouraging. As much as they would have liked things to work out, it didn't. And even when they did their best to choose God over the flesh and live humbly and appease their leadership and the different things going on, it hasn't worked out. Things have not come together. What do we do when we are in that boat? And I know this. When I went to write the book, Wounded by Leadership, I wanted to get some second opinions before I wrote it. I wanted to find out what other people were saying about the issue, how other people had dealt with their things and so forth. And you know what? I couldn't find anything. I literally went on, you know, christianbook.com, and I just typed it in, wounds by leadership, injury by leadership, hurt from leadership, all this stuff. And I couldn't seem to find anything relevant to my circumstances, to my situation, to my experience. And I said, how can this be? How can this be? And I knew that God was coaching me. I had as I was walking, and I'm going to talk about some of these things. But before we bring on our first guest, which he'll be coming in at 7:30, I'm going to share a couple elements of my own personal testimony to kind of get this whole thing kicked off. But, you know, I'm coming through all of these things, and I'm like, why is the only help that I can find, because it's not coming from the body of Christ, why is the only help that I can find in my prayer closet, in my personal time with God? Somebody should be talking about this. I mean, you have people ministering to drugs, alcohol, addictions, broken marriages, empowering leadership, sin. You have people ministering to everything, last days. You have people ministering to conspiracy theories. You got ministers in all these different areas doing all these different things. Why is nobody talking about this issue? How do I overcome this situation? I am getting arrows literally thrown at me, shot off at me in my church from my leadership, and it's hurting. How do I deal with that? Do I just run away? How do I overcome this the right way? What's the right thing to do here? And so God coached me through this. And once he got done, he said, Daniel, now you write the book. You write the book. And so I did. And hence I created this book called Wounded by Leadership, which is really designed to fill this void where not much has been said, not much material has been produced, yet it's such an abundantly relevant issue in the body of Christ right now. And what I did in the book was I got away from leader bashing. In other words, I am not here to bash leaders and talk about how terrible they are only and just say, oh man, you know, God's done with the church. Look at how bad the church is. It's corrupt. Everything you suffered is because you were in a church. You need to get out. You know, I'm totally getting away from that concept where some people in their hurt and pain and discomfort because of what they've been through have gone that direction. They said, you know, done with the church. And they find ways to argue from the Bible that God's also done with the church. But the Bible says that the bride of the Lamb is the church. In other words, God wants to marry you and me and every believer. He's taking us as his bride. How can you be done when the marriage hasn't even been consummated? In other words, Jesus hasn't come back yet. Revelation 19:7 says, "For rejoice and be glad, for the wife of the Lamb has made herself ready." So we're not looking at God being done with the church. What we're looking at God preparing a bride that is going to be a fitting vessel for him, for his son, for Jesus Christ as he is returning to take us unto himself. We cannot say that God is just done with the church because there's so many problems. What we have to do is address the problems, heal from the problems, and find what God has for us in spite of the problems. This is the angle that I'm taking. This is my heart. My heart is, one, to create tools for those that are hurting. You are hurting. You wouldn't be listening to this program called Wounded by Leadership if you weren't hurting. I mean, people, you're here because either you are hurting or you have hurt in the past or you know someone that's hurting. I'm here to create a forum that is a tool. God works all things to the good of those that love him and are called according to his purpose, including difficult leadership situations. And so that's what I want to give to you. I want you to walk away from this program with this in mind. Now, let's get started. You know, what is your story, Daniel? You're talking about this Wounded by Leadership thing. Let's hear a little bit from your testimony. My first encounter with a serious wound that I took from leadership took place when I was in high school. You see, before that, I had always been just, you know, a Christian kid, grown up in church, went to Sunday school, Bible study, did these different things. Vacation Bible School. So I knew about God. I had received Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I knew Jesus loved me. I loved him as much as I knew how at the time. And I was even baptized in water and so forth. But when I got to high school, that was when things began to really take off for me in as far as my ability to relate to God. I began to fall in love with God for the first time when I was in high school. Here's the story. I began going to a youth group at the church that my parents were attending at the time, and it was a good experience. It was a good experience. And I began to bring some of my buddies from high school, and we were all going to this youth group, and we were learning. We were having fun, playing games, doing that whole youth group high school thing. And then one of my friends that I had invited to come with me to this youth group decided to invite me to a youth group he had also been a part of the past year, before I really became friends with him. This was during my the very beginning of my senior year. He decided to invite me to this youth group. It was through a parachurch organization in the city I lived in. And so I went with him. I said, you know, we got this youth group over here, but that sounds cool. Let's check it out. Let's see what's going on over there. And we had a really good time. We had a really good time, and I felt that, you know, God is really here, and things are happening, and there's a lot of people going to this group that are also going to my high school. I know them. They're local. I make friends and so forth. This is a good thing. I decided to commit to both. At that time, I really began to grow. I really began to grow. And it was like I was getting to know God for the first time. I don't know if you are listening, you've ever had that experience where it feels like you are really getting to know God, where that relationship is moving from an information, knowledge, perspective, and be transforming into a love story. You can't get enough of him. You can't spend enough time around him. Activities that speak to his deity and glory. And you want more. And that's what began to happen to me at this time as I had committed to both youth groups. And it was a very exciting time in my life. Moreover, the leader of this particular group that my friend introduced me to, he was very charismatic, successful guy, good looking. Really seemed to have it together in the way that would appeal to a young crowd, a young guy. I looked at him, this gentleman, and I was drawn to him. I wanted his mentorship in my life. I wanted his coaching in my life. I wanted his influence in my life. And here's the thing. Young men really want adult influence in their lives. It doesn't really matter how bad they are or how difficult they may be as people, teenagers, you know. Young men want men in their lives. They may think that has died to them, but it doesn't mean they don't want it. Hear me out on this. Young men want men in their lives. And I know that as a young man, that this was absolutely true of me. But it's not like just anyone will fit the bill, so to speak. Young men want men in their lives that are strong, that are inspiring, that they look at and see characteristics in them that they want to have. And these are really the kind of men that young men want in their lives. They want men that know what they believe in. And I say, I kind of sidestep here to say, you know, as an adult man, if you want to have influence on a young crowd, ask yourself, am I strong? Do I know what I believe in? And do I inspire with the way I live my life? Because there is a sea of young people waiting to be coached and mentored by real Christians. They want it. And I wanted it. And this leader seemed, by all intents and what I could judge by, to be willing to offer that. And to the extent that he actually began to have like a deeper Bible study with me and a select group of my friends to really kind of disciple us away from the whole youth group, because it was rather large when it got started. Now, what happened from this point? As things progressed, and you know, my mom picked up on this right away, he was not the most mature believer, the most mature leader. He wasn't. And of course, I was totally blind to this because I was just excited about what was going on. Bible study, youth group, God, the whole bit. But he was kind of immature. So what did he do? He did not bring parents on board. He did not have prayer with leaders. He did not do a lot of the practical, basic, foundational things you must do as a leader if you are going to be successful. You cannot cut out prayer. You cannot cut out, especially if you're working with youth, the parents. You can't do these things. But he did, because he was excited about, you know, the young people that were excited, but his approach was a very immature approach. And so things began to fall apart as far as the youth group was concerned. But we were still having a good time trying to do the whole discipleship thing. I was still growing like crazy, and it was exciting. Until one day when everything hit the fan. In other words, the youth group had fallen apart. It was like in the beginning, you would have 50, 60 people coming to be a part of this. And it was left to him in this condition by another leader that had gone on and moved on. But by the time we were in winter, whatever, we probably had maybe like 6 or 7. And in the face of the failing effort, instead of making changes, revamping, putting the right measures in place to do it right, what he did, this individual, was bail. He just bailed. He ran away as fast as he could. He just up and disappeared. Whole youth group just disbanded. Just like that. But in the process of running away from the failing effort, what this leader did after investing time and influence and discipleship and all these things with not just me but several of my buddies, he bailed on all of us as well. He bailed. He would not so much as pick up our phone calls. And looking back, it's not really a big deal. It certainly did not stop what God has been able to do in my life. But at the time, it was difficult because I'm sitting there saying, what's wrong with me? What's wrong with my friends? Why? I understand if you leave the youth group, but you're going to also reject all of us? Why would you do that? What's your motivation? Is this what I can expect from Christian leaders? When things go wrong, they just bail out and reject you? And the thing is, in my case, I was already dealing with a lot of rejection as it was. I was not the most popular kid growing up. I talk about this in my book in further detail, but I wasn't. I had friends, but I had a lot of haters. People just didn't like me. I dealt with bullying when I was in middle school. By the time I got to high school, it continued, although on a more limited basis. But more than that, I just had a lot of people that didn't like me. And so I was always dealing with rejection. And so when I put myself in a situation where I opened myself up to the influence and discipleship and coaching and all these things with a leader, and then had him do the same thing that all these other people in my life had done already, all these peers and so forth, it hurt probably more than I even realized at the time. Because it was a long process for me to deal with all the rejection in my life. And the rejection, dealing with rejection, I mean, that process went from really started in college and went all the way up through maybe a few years ago. God's still digging stuff up. I'm like, really, that too? That much rejection on the inside of me? Really? Oh my goodness. But he has dealt with it, and I let him. But here's the thing. Finding myself in that situation where leadership had just bailed on me hurt. It hurt. It hurt me. And I believe it hurt my friends as well. I mean, they were already kind of starting to, go in other directions anyway. But the idea that a person can just be there in your life 1 minute and bail, won't even pick up your phone calls the next with no reason, no explanation, no goodbye, nothing. It's difficult, and this can taint a person's ability to follow God, because it's like pulling the carpet out from under them. It's like pulling the rug out from under them. Especially young believers, it's hard to build your foundation on Jesus Christ only, especially if your leadership is not teaching you how to do that from the very outset. Oftentimes, what new believers do is get to know God by standing on the faith and the confidence and the influence of their leaders. And that makes it that much worse when the leadership fails and falls. And this happens. And this happens. And so what I want to do is encourage you. This is going to be a whole month of talking about these kinds of issues. Rug got pulled out from under you. Your leadership, they were doing good things. And then suddenly, it's like everything just fell apart on you. You got hurt. And then it affected your ability to interact with God, go after the things of God. After this happened to me, it was towards the end of my senior year. It basically burned me out. I was very excited about God, but once the whole youth group fell apart, leader bailed, the other youth group that I had been going to, because I had committed to both at the time, I really just kind of lost interest in that, not because they did anything wrong, I just did. And but by the springtime, I was burned out. And I don't know if those of you that are listening, you may have found yourself in a similar situation. Things go south, you burn out. You're like, I am just done for now. I just don't have it in me to fight for this. And no one's fighting with me, no one's fighting for me. I'm just going with the flow. And I did. I went with the flow. I went with the flow, right? Into college, where the flow continued right into alcohol and parties and pornographic addiction and all, just right on with the flow into an abusive relationship and all this stuff. I'm not saying it was his fault. All of those things were my fault because I chose to do that. But getting the rug pulled out from under me because I was wounded by leadership was a big part of taking the fight out of me. And it's, if you've been wounded by leadership, been a part of taking the fight out of you. It's been a mountain to overcome. And so, anyway, we're at it's 7:30 right now. We should be having a guest call in a minute. And he's going to be sharing his story about how he got wounded by leadership. And so we'll be looking forward to that. We're going to take a brief break, probably just about a minute or so, put on some music. When we come back, hopefully our guests will be calling in and will be with us, and we will be continuing talking about this thing. If you are listening, feel free to call in at any time.
gone away. We've cried here for hours, and the hours turn to days. We know you regret this, leaving us here with portraits and memories that we've held so dear. When I hear same, and my question without answer is, am I the one to blame? And he was such a good description of a favorite future man. He's but well of honor people, and he said to say for him. When I hear your name, it's not the same. No matter what.
Alrighty, and we are back on Discovering the Truth with Dan Duvall. I believe our first guest is with us. Lawrence, how are you doing? Hello? Okay, let me try this.
The good works you're doing in the name of Jesus Christ, pulling together all Christians in unity.
There you are. We lost the first part of what you had just said because you weren't on, but now we have you. I apologize about that. For those of you that are listening, we have a guest calling him. I invite him on the program. His name is Dr. Lawrence Huntley. Met him at a church that we were both attending at the time, and he's just been a lovely person to know, get to know, and wonderful brother in Christ.
Hunter here.
Okay, let me take this off here. Okay. Anyway, lovely brother in Christ, And that was just so interesting that we had met when we did, because we were both coming out of situations where we had been wounded by the former circumstance that we were in as far as the leaderships that we were submitted to and what was going on. And when I met him, he was already talking about something that he wanted to produce called Judas in the Pulpit, which I understand now has largely been a project that is going forward. But I'm bringing him on to talk about Wounded by Leadership because he has definitely been there and done that. So, Lawrence, why don't you go ahead and introduce us, give us a little bit of background about you, and what led you to the church you were at before we met?
Very interesting. The kids had grown up, son. I'd moved away to Wisconsin. My wife, Norma, and I were here in Chicago. And my daughter, I think at that time, might have been in St. Louis going to school. And what we were trying to do is find a church in which we could truly involve ourselves and do the work of God. Mm-hmm. And we were between churches, so to speak. And one day I was standing in the courtyard of a Home Depot, just about to leave, and there were two adults fighting in the parking lot. The gentleman stood up and he looked at it, and he said, "What do you think of that?" And I told him, I said, "Look, if they had the Spirit of God in them, they wouldn't be acting like that. And that's no example for the kids." I said, "By the grace of God, we need to enlighten them." And he said, "What church you belong to?" I said, "None at the time." He said, "Well, come to my church." He gave me the address. I went home. I spoke to my wife. She said, "Yes, we'll go visit Sunday." We visited that Sunday, and we had an opportunity to meet the congregation. And we went back the following Sunday, and we kept going until a year later. We were really involved in the church because we observed that there were children coming here for breakfast, and the breakfast was nothing more than some crackers and cheese and some juice, you know, the sweetened juices. And I'm saying, "Well, this isn't right." And my wife said, "Hey, let's do something about it." And she was very biblical. She said, "You know, Jesus provided for the people not only spiritual food, but he provided natural food. And because they were hungry, he fed the multitude. Let us do something if we're going to be godlike." So we went out and we bought all the ingredients from Sam's Club. We bought a variety of things. And we provide them tea and coffee and other items. But after a while, we decided we need to get it. When we saw the hunger and the need of these kids, we decided to do a full meal. By the time we decided to do a full meal, the full congregation was showing up ahead of the kids to eat. And it was amazing that there were some adults who were arriving hungry too. Not only for the spiritual word, but for the natural bread. So we took it to the next level, and we had this thing going. Somehow, it invoked the spirit of indulgence among us, and soon the pastor asked me to, on Father's Day the following year, that I should do the homily, present a message on fatherhood.
So let me get this straight here. Let me get this straight. Uh-huh. You and your wife find uh-huh. this church.
Yes.
You feel drawn to this church because you see in this church a place where you can serve, you can actually be the hands and feet of Jesus to others.
Yes.
You want to do something for God.
Exactly.
And so you join this church thinking that this is going to be a place where you can get trained and taught the Word of God, submit to leadership that's going to have your best interest in mind, and serve. What I'm getting at is you weren't going in there attempting to take over the church or cause division or any of these kinds of negative things, right?
You know, Jesus came to serve. Jesus didn't come to be the powerhouse and the authority. He was already the powerhouse by the virtue that him being the Son of God. But mm-hmm. he was a humble man. And he said, in every case you look, Jesus made the blind, he gave the blind sight. He gave the crippled legs to walk on. He gave the deaf hearing. Mm.
He gave all the time. At the wedding, when there was need or shortage, he provided the wine. And when you consider all of this, the 5,000 that he served, the multitude, he gave them everything that they needed. Mm-hmm. Now, here's what happened. We went into the church to do exactly that. And when we began to do that in serving, we found the joy and satisfaction in serving. And we said to ourselves, let's stay with it. Well, here's what happened.
Yes. You're at the homily. He wants you to do a homily.
I got on the opportunity to address the congregation.
Yeah.
And I stood up. I studied maybe till 2 in the morning the Word of God so I could divide it correctly. And then when I got to the podium, It went away. The Spirit of God says, hey, no, you don't need all of that. You will speak from your heart and from the love of God. And I started, I said, let us begin with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. And got to the part that his will must be done on earth. And the fact that we must forgive those who trespass against us and lead us not into temptation. That's the most vital part. As we forgive, God will forgive. As he forgives us, we have to forgive also. And I got into that, and I put my 22 pages of a legal pad aside, and everybody was standing. There was a barely sitting room in that, standing room in that place. They had never seen that before, and they said, go ahead. So I proceeded, and I told them of the power of fathers like Joseph, who has been ignored, set aside, not talked much about, and the fact that he was a man who was a father. He was not just the producer of a child, because that child was produced by God. Mm-hmm. But at the time, when a woman would have a child for another man, in your presence, she could have been stoned to death. But he was discreet, knowing what Mary had told him. And he had the confidence in that woman that real fathers should have, in the confidence in their wives today. And that being a father, the Heavenly Father was forgiving, and so was Joseph. He was forgiving of the wife, understanding and comforting and supporting, knowing that the child he raised would eventually make a difference in the world for all of us. So we talked about fathers, and I talked about real fathers, and fathers being real men, and the significance of it, and the example we should set, and the life we should lead, and we should follow the policy that God set up, that a man should have a wife, and only one wife, and he should honor and love his wife. And I spoke about that with great emphasis, and that God has set the standards. He gave Adam a helpmate that was Eve. Mm-hmm. He did not give a helpmate that was Steve. So God set the principle. And I got through. And the following week, I was with the City of Chicago diversity program to invite people over to your home. And my wife and I sponsored a dinner, and we had quite a few people home. So we were unable to handle the crowd. So we had a young lady who was working in the vestry of the church. We asked her, we hired her to help serve. And she came over. At the end of the appear, she told us as we were cleaning up, she says, what happened? Why you weren't at the birthday party? And I said, which birthday party? She said, the deacon's wife, the top deacon, had a birthday party. And I said, I didn't know about it. She said, but everybody knew. So it was a concerted effort not to include me in that program, because that person had a child that was not living the physical life of the person they were born to be. That's the mildest way I can say it. And that my presentation and my sermon about being a man and being directly a man and a woman, and a man marries a woman, and a woman is provided by God, and if God provides it, that's the best for you. He didn't provide a woman for a woman or a man for a man. really upset them because there were members who were involved in this. The sad thing about it is that when that happened, we got indirectly, I don't know what you call it, exonerated from the church.
Mm-hmm.
We went and I found it very hollow and cold and indifferent.
Oh.
And because we had gone on a vacation, and when we came back, we didn't prepare for the usual breakfast and thing, and nothing happened. And people were walking around with long faces and sad moves. I must tell you this. I saw a grown man cry when I talk about how a father forgives and how a father must care. But the touching part was that when we went back, people had come to see us, and they didn't find us because we were on a vacation. And when we went back, there was a whole distorted attitude.
So
now we used negative attitude because we spoke the truth.
You went into a church. You were looking.
Let me.
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead.
So what happened in the following Sunday? I think we had gone to a wedding Saturday night. We came out, we were tired, and we rolled over in bed. It was almost 8 o'clock. And it used to take us, let me see. We always, after the incident, we found ourselves going to church 5 minutes to 8, and church began at 8 o'clock, and 3 minutes to 8, or we rushing in at 8 o'clock itself. And I couldn't understand why that was a pattern. But then, when we were home that Sunday morning, a friend called and said, oh, we dialed the wrong number. I said, no, this is our number. You're right, because I recognize the voice. He said, what you doing? I said, you going to church? Yeah, I've got to go to church. I said, okay, what time your church start? And church start at 9 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
We made it to church 45 minutes away within a half an hour. And we were late for church that was 15 minutes away or running late on a regular basis. The spirit had gone out of us. But God gave me a new hope and a new opportunity. My wife said to me, you are on assignment. Don't think that it happened accidentally. A meeting in a Home Depot parking lot, you went up in the church, you give them a sermon to set them straight. And then, oh, by that's a double entendre. Set them straight. And then, here comes, you're invited to another church. We went to that church and we developed the same momentum. And we presented a proposal for them to go out into the highways and byways and spread the word. And we set up a fantastic system. I checked it out. And I've had experience in organizing things in the natural world as a former director of tourism for the U.S. Virgin Islands government.
Yes.
But here I was doing something on the godly part. And I put everything together. And the assistant pastor told me, I run it by him. He said, you can't give that to the pastor directly. You should give it to me so I could check it over and make sure it's done right. I said, well, I went by the word of God, and I prayerfully and hopefully think that it is right. You say, well, you need to give me. I said, well, this is the only copy I have right now. And next thing I know, he had made a presentation to the pastor that he has a major program that he's going to take out in the field based on the synopsis of what I shared with him. When I felt the degree of rejection, and degree of hurt of going so far the first time and the second time, they said a burned child dreads fire, I backed off at a proposal. And they went forward with it. But my wife told me something very important. She says, look, you are being tested. Malachi 3:3. Just as the silversmith holds the silver in the fire, God holds you in his hands. You're going through the heat and the testing. So I checked out why it is that happened and said, you know, the reason the silver goes through the fire is to be purified.
Yep.
And he has to hold it in there until it's just right. He holds it too long, it's chaff. It jumps out too soon, it's unpurified and cannot make a jewel of distinction. But it has to be right there a certain time. I found out that the reason that sometimes you go through the heat and the fire and you're tested like we have been tested, is that the jeweler has to hold, the silversmith has to hold the silver in the fire. And the only way he can tell it's just right is when he sees his reflection in it. The same happens for us. When we're going through the heat and we know that we are in God's hands, we can take the heat until we reflect godly qualities. In essence, you have to reflect back to God the images and attitudes of a godly person, and then you become a gem in his hand. So if I were wanting, I would really like everyone to know that when you're challenged and you get wounded, when your feelings are hurt, don't let that be the last issue. There are three elements. One, you could hurt your emotions. And emotion, the key word in it is motion. You're all over the place and you're trying to find a groove. If your feelings are hurt, you react according to the flesh. But if you don't allow your feelings to be hurt by simple things, you will gain enough strength through faith to stand up to the circumstance. And you would find yourself spiritually strong. Turn to the Word. It says, "Seek, turn not to thine own understanding, but acknowledge God in all your ways, and he will direct your path." I have found that to be one of the most helpful things to me, because sometimes I would say, by my emotions, by my feelings, by my passion, I'm going to do this, I'm going to get even. But God knows better than that. God's hand is bigger than mine. And he could take care of the challenges that may come forward, that when you get wounded, I want to tell everyone, don't try to find your own resolve. God's hands are bigger than yours. And he could correct things, change things, and lift you to a height way and above. Sometimes that test might best be a test until you show your godly behavior, and God would give you another assignment. I heard many times, and not in one church, but in many churches, that you don't just happen in a church. God sends you. He hears your cry, and he will deliver you. Any man who calls upon his name and asks of it in Jesus' name, it would be given unto them. A very strong thing is that many people ask for things, and they have to go through their pastor. They have to go through the deacon. They have to go through anyway. God has given us direct dial. He said, "Ask it of me. Ask it of my Father in my name, and it shall be given unto you."
Yes, so that's really good. And you raise a really good point. You raise a really good point here. This is something that we need to understand. And this is something that's probably going to come out repeatedly throughout the month, is this thing. Oftentimes, hold on 1 second. We're bringing on our second guest, so kind of be overlapping.
Okay,
what I wanted to bring out is what you said is very important. God uses negative experiences with spiritual leadership to build and grow us. He actually uses it to mature us. They become part of God's solution to our inadequacies. In other words, by getting burned, God is really keeping us in that fire. That's such a good word. And there's another thing I want to comment on. You brought out what happened in your former church, which is something that a lot of people, I believe, have gone through, in that they get on fire beyond the limit that fire is allowed in a specific group. So you touched on an issue that was, while it was rooted in the Word of God, was not one of the things you talk about in that group of people, and that brought you under the hammer. And something similar happened to me, because when I was at a certain church, I started talking about spiritual gifts. I got the same hammer. I mean, it just whack. Next thing I know, they're asking me, babe, with so many words, to leave, because it was outside of their periphery. They're not touching that issue. And You know, I'm glad that you brought this up because you illustrate for us this happens. But in the midst of it happening, if we have our priorities right and we keep God at the center of it, keep looking to God to be our answer and let him guide us in the midst of it, we don't have to get thrown off track by negative experiences with leadership. We can get maturity and refining instead.
That, and we come a shining jewel in God's eye. We are not here to impress the world. We are here to glorify God, recognizing him, giving the honor and the praise and the recognition for everything he does. But without God, nothing is possible. With God, everything is possible. So we have to remember, when you get hurt, if even you stumble, do not fall. You could hold on to the word of God, and it will lift you up. If you feel challenged, remember that you are challenged basically on the basic elements of nature. The five elements is touching, hearing, tasting, smelling, and seeing. And that if you see that you are not making progress within the church, don't go up against it. Pray that God's presence would come in, because the least shall be the greatest. We have to follow his word. His word was good yesterday, today, and tomorrow, and forever. So we have to be conscious. If you are touched by things that may upset you, don't let that get to you. If you are within, I would say, the odor of negative conversation, do not be touched by that. Let your soul be touched only by the spirit, because we have five senses and they are of the flesh. But your spiritual sense is the one of God. It's the thing that gives you faith and courage and desire to step forward. If you trust in God, he will always deliver for you, because he delivered Christ from the dead. He can deliver us from the earthly circumstances. And on going on, letting your other guests come on, I just want to say one thing. That one of the greatest powers is that even when you're challenged by those who are of the cloth, and they feel challenged because of what you bring to the altar, that you should still do what Jesus did, even though they prosecute you. Jesus said in his dying breath, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Oh, and that is the example we should take.
That's a good word, brother. I want to say thank you so much, Dr. Huntley, for coming on, for sharing your experience, your thought, and a lot of really good words. Man, honestly, you said quite a bit. Thank very you. Valuable insights to the whole thing. So,
I thank God for this opportunity, this blessed opportunity. I thank you for being so kind as to hold me in high esteem. And I know, through the grace of God, may your program continue to be blessed and expand from state to state, Amen. From nation to nation. That's May God grant you these blessings. And he says, if two or more are on one accord, God's blessing is felt. The best to you, Mr. Duval.
Okay. You have a good night. Thank you so much.
Thank you. The pleasure is mine. Good night.
Good night. For those of you that are listening, this is Discovering the Truth with Dan Duval, our guest that just left, talking about his wounds that he took from leadership and sharing with us, Dr. Lawrence Huntley. We're going to bring on another guest now, another friend of mine I'm very grateful for, because this gentleman was one of the first people to open the door to me when I wrote my first book, Noah's Ark and the End of Days, to come on a program, share some of the things that I believe that God had, you know, given me, shown me, put on my heart. And so I was very grateful for that. Just an absolute vault of information and insights. But like me, and we have several things really, really strongly in common, he has seen the need for unity in the body of Christ. He has seen that as an agenda of God, and has even taken certain steps to see to that happening in his own life. But also, like me, he has experienced wounds by certain leadership. And so I asked him to come on the program for the first show to kind of talk about these things with me, share some of his experience, his insights into the issues, and bless us. So thank you so much, Jim, for coming on.
Thank you, Dan, for Daniel, for having me. You know, it's come a long way. I remember when you first wrote that book, and I was excited about it because I saw more of a not just the Genesis 6 and, you know, having a good understanding of it, but you included something that I thought for a while has been a big lacking element, and that was the spiritual dimension of practical application. How does it apply to, you know, it's neat to know these things, but what does that mean in our life? How should that draw ourselves closer to the Lord? And that's an element you've always been able to maintain in your work, and that's why I've always appreciated it.
Thanks. Thanks so much. And for those of you that are listening, Jim Wilhelmsen is not just an average Joe here. He is a minister. He has written the book. It's called and I read it.
Beyond Science Fiction.
Beyond Science Fiction. Thank you. It was just a total blank there. Man, talk about a book that is just full of documentation and research and insight. Wow. Yeah, that, you know, it took me personally, and I'm a reader, it took me a while to get through your book, simply because I was learning so much as I went through. I definitely want to recommend to anyone that's listening, check out his work. You will definitely learn something through it. And also, his website, echoesofenoch.com. Jim.
Yeah.
You came into Christ. How old were you when you first met Jesus?
I was 23 years old. I'm 60. I'll be 62 in July.
Okay. Wow. Yeah. So it's been a while.
Most of my life.
Now, why don't you give us a little bit of background? What was the initial kind of ministry that you came up through, and when did it start to go south as far as leadership then becoming an obstacle as far as your ability to go after the things of God?
Well, in 1974, I read the book Late Great Planet Earth, and although I don't agree or go along with a lot of the eschatology that's in there, thank God that that Hal Lindsey had the sinner's prayer at the very end, and I was so impressed with the idea that I was 23 years old. I had already been through all amazing amount of weird stuff happened in my life, but at 23, I was read this book, and I was so impressed with the idea that the Bible could actually describe accurately a lot of the 20th century things that were going on today, that it caused me for the first time in my life to say, if Jesus, if you are who you say you are, come into my heart. You know, I surrender. I'd be crazy not to let you be Lord of my life. And he answered me right then and there. And it was for me, it was very dramatic. I started bawling like a baby. And I think years of fear and bitterness and anger and hurt just, you know, came gushing out. And I just felt a warm envelope of God's love just come into me. And it was so real that it's lasted me for all these different years. So that was my first step. I was raised on Darwin. I didn't go to church. My mom and dad would feel guilty sometimes and send us, when we were little kids, to a local Baptist church for Sunday school or whatever. But basically, you know, was raised on Darwin. By the time I was an avid reader at an early age, so by the time I was 12, 13, I was reading college textbooks on paleontology and wanted to be a paleontologist.
Wow.
So Darwin was my religion, I guess you might say, for a long time. So how I, you know, it's just crazy how different things in life. I was in a lower class country neighborhood that was kind of taken over by business professional people. All of a sudden we were on the wrong side of the track, and I was made aware of class distinction and a lot of hurts from that right away. Well, I rebelled, and I ended up, of all things, going from a nerdy geek study, you know, straight-A student to packing a 45 pistol, rode a Harley Chopper, got involved in bike gangs, and really had given up on life until I was confronted with real life and death situations, and that kind of sobered me up. Then a little thing called the Vietnam War and the draft, the next thing you know, I found myself in OD Green, and that really helped me grow up as an adult, but I was still very secular. Unlike most people, when I got saved, I wasn't at the bottom of my world when I got saved. I actually, you know, got off drugs, got off of the bike gangs, just through sheer determination to make a better life for myself and begin to have some kind of hope for a vision. I escaped a death situation while I was in the Army, and that's really what woke me up and started drawing me more to a spiritual things. But I really wasn't open to Jesus yet. I had a friend of mine that I rode with, got saved and wore a suit and changed overnight, and he just kind of freaked me out. But, you know, as much as he did, he wasn't afraid to share the word, and he quoted some scriptures to me. And even though at the time I thought he went stone crazy, those scriptures stayed with me. And something that the Lord was able to start ministering to me. So by the time I was ready to read that book, I had been prepared. But I had gotten out of the bike gangs, gotten out of drugs, pretty much. And I have to say that it was by God's grace and mercy. But in my own mind, I did this myself. I did this just because I was determined to make a good life for myself. So at 23, I had my own business. I was working as an independent metal sculptor, had my own mini gallery in a mini mall. Had just graduated college using my VA benefits, had a wife, a kid, had a home already half paid for, and one car that I had, a new car that it was almost done being paid for, and a second car that my wife, so, you know, for a 23-year-old kid, I had come a long way in a short time.
And it
was disciplined by, you know, applying myself. But unfortunately, that's where my vanity was, too. I felt I was doing this. And
I understand how that can be.
So that I had to give you that background, kind of explain how in the heck is a guy that pioneered one of the first evangelical Christian motorcycle clubs end up in a very high, heady, kind of a cranial ministry of apologetics dealing with UFOs and aliens. Well, welcome to my world. I've never done anything in the box. I've always done everything, you know, outside and wild and crazy, yet still I like to believe by retaining the basic core beliefs of our faith. I've never strayed away from that, but I've had the ability to think outside of the box, to do different things that have never been done before, to fill in gaps. It just seems to be, you know, my calling and what God has done. Unfortunately, by doing that, though, being outside of the box, you get a lot of, you know, you're really misunderstood by a lot of people.
Yes. Yes. And, I you know, just jumping in, because I'm going to let you continue in a second. I remember when I first wrote the manuscript for Noah's Ark and the End of Days. And for those of you that have heard my program before, you'll know where I stand on this issue. I believe in hybrids. I believe that the Bible is very clear that hybrids have existed, definitely in a form of angel-human hybrids, based on Genesis 6, which you mentioned earlier, where angels came in to the daughters of men and had children by them, called them Nephilim. But also that what's coming on this world, what's coming to this earth, is going to be as it was in the days of Noah. And that the church needs to be prepared. And see, Jim is on the same page with this. And he really deals with the whole alien side of things. He's done a lot of research into that as far as how that's tied in. And definitely a lot of research into Nazi Germany and everything that went along with the Nazi agenda and how that's bled into what's even happening today. So when he says that, you know, he's dealt with some of these things, I mean, he really, really has. And yes, when I first – and I'm not touching on all the stuff you did. I'm just saying I was just talking about Genesis 6 and saying, well, this is what it says. It says angels came into the women and they had children. That's what I say in the beginning of the book. I don't really even go that deep. I gave it to another minister, and he said, I absolutely reject this. I cannot endorse this book at all. I don't believe this. I wouldn't recommend it to my friends. You need to, you know, learn about some other theories. It's called the Sethite theory, which is what I was taught and what makes sense. And this, and so this rejected right out the box, you know, boom, done. And I understand what you're saying, So please, you know, with that said, continue. Sometimes it's just hard when God explains something to you, and then you have to put that idea across to others. Rejection's guaranteed.
That is something that, you know, that where the Lord says that he tests us and tries us, and we're called. We're called by our faithfulness through the trials that he's going to put before us. And what I've seen it seems like to be a series. Romans 8:28 says, "And we know that all things work together for good to them who love God, to them who are called according to his purpose." Now, to love God means that he first loved us. We come to him. We have a relationship with him. We have that love. But called according to his purpose means simply that we're agreeing with God. We're agreeing with God that everything can work out for the best, even the adversities, even the rejection, even the things that we're going to be attacked with. And the way I see this is it's all part of God's promise, his sovereignty. It's all part of spiritual warfare. Satan looks at us, all of us, as like a chain link or a chain. We're only as strong as our weakest link. So it's only natural. He's going to attack us at our weakest link. Now, God takes the same thing, and he says, you know what? I can make lemonade out of this lemon. He's going to attack you in this weak area, but you know what? You keep your eyes focused on me. Trust my promises. You're going to get through this. You're going to be made stronger. I'm going to take this weak link. It's not going to destroy you. It's going to make you stronger. I'm going to take that weak link, and we're going to make it strong. So you're just going to go on from one glory to another, to another, to another. If you believe Romans 8:28, all things work together for good. So that means we're always in a win-win situation. And sometimes, I'll tell you, Dan, it's hard when we are in this virtual world. Some things seem so real. And, I mean, you know, I don't always have the first, best, most spiritual reaction either. This is something that's, you know, transpired over almost 40 years of following the Lord. And you do get better at it. And it gets the trials get harder, but the ability to endure them gets easier because you've had so many other past memories to rely upon, to remember, hey, he got me through this, he can get me through that. He got me through all these other things, the same thing here. So
now that's
good. We can just know that these things are going to happen because we're engaged in a spiritual warfare. If we're living our lives like we're engaged in battle, we're being a warrior for the Lord, we're doing things, the more you step on Satan's toes, the more he's going to attack. But the more he's going to attack, the more God is going to strengthen you. So we never arrive at a perfect place, but we always arrive at a better place. We keep our eyes on the Lord and his promises, and don't let the discouragement, don't let the hurts, don't let any of these things cause a root of bitterness, cause us to let it destroy us, to tear us down. If we keep focused on the promises that, hey, this can be a win-win situation. It doesn't have to be a catastrophe. One of the things that I have done that I think... noticed that when I got involved in this whole, I guess you might say, I don't know how to put it, almost a subculture of people that have been a part of the awakening to realize what Genesis 6 is really saying. Mm-hmm. Because it is rather important. And it is an awakening. It's something that hasn't been, it's been recently understood by many. And believe it or not, because I don't think I've ever even told you this, that my first sermon on Genesis 6 as related to the possible alien scenario today, in 1978, I think there were maybe two books out, Crash Go the Chariots and The Sons of God Return. Those are the only two books known on this planet back in 78 and 80 that addressed the Genesis 6 issue. It was mostly not understood for being what it was by anyone. Later, a few years later, I.D.E. Thomas did his most famous work, pioneer work, The Omega Conspiracy. And, I mean, that book is foundational. Everybody should read that book first. He's got a Ph.D. He teaches out of California. He's in his 90s now. Fantastic book. Chuck Missler, of course, his book, Alien Agenda. These were the groundbreaking books that provided all the rest of us with a launching or starting point for understanding the Genesis 6 paradigm. And once you understand that, it changes your whole perspective on everything else. Unfortunately, it also will usually ostracize you from your local church if you talk too much about it. Because it's new stuff that the church on a whole is not willing to take. What I've noticed through the years, now first gave my first sermon in 1978, but I didn't really get involved in this, wasn't called into it, because I was too busy pioneering a Christian motorcycle ministry, which had never been heard of before. But it wasn't until 1996, almost 20 years later, that I got called into this ministry full-time. When I did, I was still on, I'd say, like maybe the second wave of an awakening. That would be along the lines with Stan Dale, L.A. Marzulli, myself, Dave Flynn, of course. He had probably the only website out presenting a biblical perspective on UFOs and aliens. So we were like the second wave. I could have been in the first wave, but God had other plans for me. My point is, I've been doing this a long time, longer than most of the people that are doing it today. So I've been around since almost the beginnings of this awakening. And what I've noticed through the years is that I was also one of the people that had more pastoral experience behind me. Many people were brand new, never had been in any kind of Christian leadership. Some were just practically brand new to being Christians, and then they're thrusting themselves into researching probably one of the most guarded secrets that Satan has. And I hate to say it, some have been torn to pieces, some have had gone to remote extremes, and in almost all the cases where their doctrines have been, they've strayed away from the core issues, it's either a lack of grounding, a lack of preparation from the Lord, and kind of thrusting themselves ahead of, you know, getting deeper into things that taking the time to get a basic discipleship program set up on, within their lifestyle and within their thinking and makeup, and they didn't. And the others, even some that are more seasoned, more a little more trained and prepared, the biggest thing that Satan has been able to do to get people off on a track on extremities is they start looking at the church from the results of being rejected and from being disappointed and being, you know, booted out outright. Some, I mean, almost everybody that is in this kind of ministry can have heartbreaking tales of where they've lost their jobs. L.A. Marzulli lost his job as a music minister and, you know, has, this, I think, a master's degree in it. And he lost it because he wouldn't compromise on his stand on Genesis 6. And many other people have been kicked out or put out of churches, myself included. Here's the thing, though. You can't look. If you start looking at the church on a whole as the enemy, and they're evil, and you know they're done with, and there's nothing good in the church at all, and you know you forsake it and walk away, you become the lone ranger, and a lone ranger will always become a lone stranger. You're the walking wounded man, and you're separating yourself from the rest of the crowd. And guess what? Watch any kind of documentary on predatory animals, and they always look for the straggler that's behind and all by himself. And they'll get tore up and chewed up.
So go ahead. Finish making your point, because you're doing a great job.
I was just gonna say, we cannot, you know, Martin Luther tried within all that he could to work within the structure and the framework of a very ungodly structure and framework of the Holy Roman Empire, but he did everything he could the right way before he finally completely broke off. You don't just break off out of hurt, out of retaliation, out of anger. We can't look at the rest of the church as strangers, as people that don't get it, so, you know, be damned with them or whatever. We can't let that fruit of bitterness get into us. We have to see them as, okay, they're our family. They might be blind, they might be cruel to you, they might be hurting you, but you know what? They just don't know what they're doing. Forgive them, Lord, they don't know. And we look at them as family members that maybe are just not the brightest bulb or the brightest crayon in the box, but and that might sound a little condescending, but you know what? You have to look at it that way. You have to still see them as family. You don't oppose them. This is why one particular website, she first came out, she had some basic stuff. This was back in the, I want to say around 2002, 2003. Now she is a major proponent of false doctrines, mixing in reincarnation, mixing in a lot of Gnostic literature and sources. Now, I refer to them only as the sense that I'm looking over Satan's shoulder to see what he's up to and then explain to the body of Christ how this is a deception and why and how it can parallel what we would be comfortable with, but this is not the same thing. They may use the same terms, but they have different meanings for it. But where she is just this person is integrating all of this stuff into some cosmic weirdness that just is, deviates from the core issues of the faith. She's allowed her faith and her belief to be shipwrecked by infusing all this. And the reason is she has no foundation. She never had a foundation solidly grounded in the Word of God. So she listens to all these heavy winds of doctrine. And this is very typical within the whole, within this whole community. There's a large level of people that thrust themselves in because they're either interested or fascinated and want answers, but they haven't allowed themselves to be prepared in ministry. I would say part of the blame is cyberspace, the opportunity to have a format to touch and reach hundreds, thousands of people, and what discerning value do they have, whether the people really know what the heck they're talking about, and what kind of trail have they left behind them.
Those are really great points, and it's all true. What I want to do now is kind of come back and get specific on your story, because I mean everything you've been saying is great. But now, like, let's talk about here you are, Jim. You're a young guy. You're beginning this stuff, whatever. How did it come down on you?
Well, I know with the Christian Bike Ministry, of course, you know, how do you integrate a motorcycle club structure to an ecclesiastical organizational structure? You know, and how can a biker do that anyway? You know, you're alley-oop, man. You're just a Neanderthal caveman riding a Harley. You don't know how to do that kind of stuff. Well, I did, and I did. and it was trial and error, and it was, you know, a lot of prayer and making a lot of mistakes. But from the mistakes, I had to believe God to get it right. I knew I was called to do this, and I had to do it the best I could, and I didn't always get it right, but God was allowed me to shape and form a ministry that was very effective. When we first came on the scene, my own pastor, he wouldn't support me or be behind me in any way. I kind of wanted him. I wanted to be under someone. I had never been a pastor before. I wrote Christian tracts and literature. I had been a minor role in occasionally not really teaching, but occasionally filling in for a teacher, you know, and I was more of a facilitator, not a teacher. I did have a mentor who taught me how to use all the reference materials, and I learned quick. Then I went into Bible college, and from that, but by the time I went into Bible college, I was already pastoring, but I had already been a Christian for 3.5 years, and I had been very discipled and very disciplined. So I began to learn. But even in that place where they saw me grow up in the faith, when I got involved in starting a Christian bike club, that was just too outside of the box. You know, and so everybody took a step back. Well, I was disappointed, but I understood that this was new. They had to see the from it. So I didn't get upset at them. I didn't get angry. I didn't get mad. A little disappointed that I didn't get the support. But I put myself through an understanding, okay, Lord, then you're going to have to make special provisions if you want this to become a reality. We started out just simply having a Bible study. I witnessed and shared my faith on my bike, passed out tracts, invited people to a coffee house that didn't even exist yet because we didn't even have a clubhouse yet. But I explained to the people, I wasn't trying to embellish anything. I was explaining, well, this is the vision I have and this is what we're going to eventually have. But, you know, get back with me and I'll let you know when we're open for business and you can come and be a part of the coffee house or whatever. Well, in less than a year, I had probably over a dozen people that were committed that shared the same vision. Most of them had gotten saved directly through our evangelistic efforts. Some of them had, you know, heard about this and wanted to see what this kind of ministry was like. Long story short, in about 2 or 3 years, we had so many people come to Christ through our ministry that my pastor realized, wow, this is of God. I can't oppose this. I got to help it. And so, you know, by not letting bitterness or anger or from disappointment or hurt take over, but just being persistent that, hey, okay, let's keep our eyes on the vision of what God has called me to do the best I can. I know I could do better if I had more support, but you know what? Let's just do it anyway and see how this thing can grow. So many people end up coming to Christ that the next thing you know, we were eventually accepted only by people seeing the fruit of the ministry, which was people's lives changed, people's lives being drawn to Christ. So that was I didn't know that this was just all in preparation for the next step. How do you go from Harley choppers to aliens and saucers? You know, that was a weird jump even for me.
So before you make the jump, let me just bring out this point. You yeah. said, by not giving in to bitterness, it allowed God the room to bear fruit under difficult circumstances.
Absolutely. And that is a key. And, you know, it's hard because it means that you have to look into yourself and not look at others. You have to look into yourself saying, Lord, I am pissed off. I'm angry. I'm mad. I don't like what they did. Please change me. I know this is wrong. I won't go any further if I don't get over this. You know, forgiveness is not an option. It's a demand. And yet we have to see in our human weakness, we're not going to get it. I think sometimes, you know, I think we have good intentions. We know that we can't overcome it ourselves. So we try to put on the outer veneer that, well, okay, I got to act this way. I got to say this is the right thing to say. This is the right way to act. So this is the way I have to behave. But you can still let that, it can still be festering inside. So you have to actually humble yourself and go to God. And it's not that we are, there's pride separating us. I think sometimes we just don't realize, oh, you know what, I got to actually ask God to get rid of this. First, I got to acknowledge it's there. Okay, you know what, God, I am angry. I am mad. I don't like what happened to me. I don't like, this is not fair. And Lord, I'm mad right now. You know, I guess what I'm trying to say is it is, it's good and it's okay to vent to God.
Yes.
You better be venting to him and not anyone else, really. But sometimes it's good to vent to God. And when you do that, God is that allows an open door for God to come in and start healing it. So you don't have to just say the right thing and act the right way. You can do it because you really mean it, because you had something transform inside of you that changed you so you can get through it.
But I wonder if you could hear me. Could I intercept on this? Am I there?
You are still alive.
Okay. The beautiful thing of what he just said is that first you have to confess your sins. When you tell God what's really bugging you, you are being honest, upright, and open. God can't fix something that he doesn't know needs fixing in you. He has the power, but he gave us domain in this realm that we could call upon him to act on our behalf. When you also confess, you are humbling yourself. You're saying to God, this is a big deal with me. Put your hand upon it. And these confessions, you acknowledge him in all your ways, he will direct your path. God will give you the peace beyond all understanding. If you would kneel down and pray to God that he would make the change, if you put it in God's hand, you are humbling yourself. Humility is a vital part of change. It says the meek shall inherit the earth. The proud in heart will never see God's face. You have to be humble. And to be humble is give unto God that which is God's. God has the authority, the ability, and the power. And when you give it to God, the battle is no longer yours. It's now God's battle, and his hands are bigger than yours. You have addressed it in a beautiful way. I just had to get in on that because I need some of that humility too, and I need some of that confidence. And I'm confessing now.
Amen.
Amen. You know, and it's like even it works the other way too. When I was a young pastor, you know, you don't pick and choose your congregation. It's like a poker hand. You're dealt the cards you're dealt with, and that's what you got to work with. And there's been times when I've said, Lord, I don't like this person. I'd rather dot their I. I don't want to lay hands on them. I want to lay knuckles on them. I'm sorry, Lord. I have this attitude at this person. I don't like them. Please change my heart. I need to be there for them. And right now, I can't be because I just see too much flesh and I don't see anything good. So let me see that person the way you see him. Let me understand. Change my heart. I need a change of heart with this person. I mean, we all, let's face it, I don't care. We haven't arrived where we could just embrace everybody all the time. But we have a boss, maybe a person at work. You know, it's all of us as Christians, man. Satan makes sure that we got either a boss or somebody at work that's always on our haunches, always, you know, following us. And it seems as Satan is always trying to get a root of bitterness in us. So We have to turn the tables around, and we have to first admit our humanness, you know, humanness, that, hey, you know, I'm really not feeling the way I should be feeling, so please, can you rearrange this? And it's incredible how the Lord will do it. He'll put you through some life experiences, some challenges that will allow you to see what that other person is really all about and what he's like. Maybe you'll have to wear his shoes for a time, be in the same situation that he is to really get it, to understand. But know that, you know, if you're willing to do that, then all things are going to work together for good, like Romans 8:28 says, because you're agreeing with God. You're agreeing that, hey, I'm weak, you're strong, I'm not, I don't get it, you get it, show me, I need to get past this. And you can. When I got involved in the UFO alien thing, it was far worse than anything I had ever thought. You know, when the King's Kids, that was the Christian bike ministry they had, when we first started, we didn't get any support. People said, oh, look at those carnal Christians, this is crazy, how can you do that, that's blasphemy. And so we went from there to being on the 700 Club. We had the Detroit News do a Sunday magazine article on our ministry that went syndicated throughout the whole country. The next thing you know, we're starting a youth ministry that we never anticipated, and we had more people come to Christ through the youth ministry than we did from our evangelistic efforts to the outlaw motorcycle clubs. I was starting to help people all over the country start similar ministries, traveling, and went to spoke at just about every denomination in the city of Detroit. I became a pretty well-known figure and accepted as a credible, reputable minister. And as people knew more and more of our ministry and as it grew, I also got the respect of being a very well-balanced, well-presented minister.
Mm-hmm.
But that all changed as soon as I got involved with UFOs and aliens. All of a sudden, you hear what that Wilhelmson's into now? Man, he's gone new age. He's lost it. He's off into all this weird stuff in him. He's talking about Nazis and all this crazy stuff, just totally crazy. Now, I started this ministry, and I got called into it, rather, in 1996. And like I said, that was about the beginning of the second wave. When I posted my first website, there was 5 websites on the Internet that presented a biblical perspective of UFOs, aliens, and the paranormal and supernatural. There was nothing else throughout the whole world on this. I was one of the first. And believe me, we were met with hostility, and the most anger came from the church, came from fellow believers. They had automatically just assumed that we had defected over to the New Age. Man, my main thing was proclaiming how dangerous the New Age was. I had just read Constance Cumby's book. Talk about weird circumstances. Constance Cumby is a lawyer from Michigan, here right in the Detroit area where I'm at. She made, I think, still one of the best books showing how theosophy is the foundation of the New Age movement, but it was also the foundation for the Nazi movement. The New Age and the Nazis are one in the same. If you want to know who the real neo-Nazis are, they're not the ball-headed, goose-stepping, Sieg Heil swastika-wearing rock punks of today. Okay. They're your New Age fruits that are embracing God and all and all in God. They look like polar opposites, but they believe in the same system. Well, this woman, Constance Cumby, did an excellent job of putting one of the best books together ever to show the consistency and the similarities of the New Age movement and the philosophical essence of the Nazi movement, the fact that they were an occult-based society, occult-based government. Now, her main nemesis, who's been on her haunches, called her a heretic and just horrible things, was my mentor, the guy that I learned how to do research with. If he knew, and I don't think that he does, I haven't seen or had contact with him in over 30-some years, if he knew what I was doing today, he'd probably be on my haunches too. How weird is that?
It's weird. You know, the world is such a small place. Now, I want to get into this too, because you said you were one of 5 in at the time that had this website and so forth. Now, you made efforts at one point to try to bring people together that were all noticing the same thing. Now this was now kind of on the other end where you're really trying to bring together leaders as opposed to getting wounded by being submitted unto a leader. But when you try to do some things to bring people together, it backfired. Why don't you tell us about that, some of the reasons why it backfired and so forth? Because this was, I remember you told me, it was like, wow.
This is just fairly recent, and I was heartbroken. I haven't really shared this with too many people, but I'm just coming through all of this, and I had to actually be put in a life-threatening physical illness that I went through, where I was getting checked and examined. My wife was going through the same thing. We thought she might have bone cancer. She had a lot of other issues going on. So she was faced with a lot of things all of a sudden in a physical way. I was being faced with, I've got Barrett's disease, which is a precancerous condition of the esophagus. That's the bad news, but the good news is the cancer that forms is so slow in forming that it's easily detected before it becomes terminal. But for a long time there, they thought I already had it, and it was in the pancreas, and so I'm getting checked. And, you know, living in a situation where all of a sudden I may not be around much longer, boy, I'll tell you, that causes you to be very reflective on yourself, where your ministry's going, where it's been, what changes, you know, Lord, give me a clear picture of everything, what's going on here. But this was right after I had tried to get, we don't call ourselves prophets anymore, we call ourselves watchmen. It's, you know, because the word prophet has been so abused by so many wackos that, you know, watchmen is a preferred name tag for the prophetic ministry. So many of us that are involved, because, I mean, this has been a great awakening within the church. I have seen in the last 15 years, I've seen it go to a handful of people. To, you go on online now, and there's thousands, I mean thousands of websites presenting a biblical perspective on the whole UFO, alien, and paranormal, supernatural stuff in general, which means apparently that we did our work, and we did it well, and now it's growing exponentially. I can't even keep up with, you know, who's who and some of the newer people that are involved. But what one thing that started concerning me was that I saw almost all of us, and I didn't even realize to what extent, almost all of us had gone through a lot of heartbreaking hurts, a lot of suffering, personal loss that we had, either with spouses, with family, with occupations, if it was church-related, where we lost positions as teachers or even preaching, booted out of the denomination if you're staunchly, you know, going to address supernatural paranormal issues, or the Genesis 6, you're going to hold tight to the fallen angel Nephilim idea, rather, as opposed to the Sethite lie. We've all paid a lot of prices, so we're carrying emotional baggage, and yet we are the front line of defense for the coming delusion and deception that's going to be put upon the earth. And many of the people are at different spiritual levels, and I'd say most of them, especially recently, are not on a spiritual level where they need to be. Now, part of the problem is just the nature of the beast. Because we have been put out of the churches, we do not have the support, spiritual support, that we need as leaders. And so if we are able to develop some kind of check and balance with each other, and some people do group off so they're not just totally isolated, but unfortunately, collectively as a body, we're not together, and we're not being supported by the body on a whole. So we're too isolated. So what I tried to do was to get a creative forum where all of us could get together, where we could share our thoughts, our beliefs, and our ideas. Some of that started to evolve from the Ancient of Days conferences in Roswell. I ended up moving to Roswell, and Guy Malone had started the Ancient of Days conferences, and that started to allow us to get to know each other, to share ideas and thoughts. And so from that, I was saying, you know, we need more. We need to actually be a body that can be committed to each other, to be submitted to each other, that we can iron sharpening iron, that we can encourage each other, we can find the different pieces of the puzzle that we have and how they fit. But unfortunately, you know, instead of looking at how everything fits, we're too threatened and feel intimidated, and we've got all this baggage, emotional baggage from being hurt before, and we're on the defensive, that instead of seeing how our pieces come to the table and fit all together, we're sitting there feeling threatened because, well, oh, you've you believe Prince Charles is the Antichrist. I think it's Hitler, and he thinks it's Nimrod. And how can we have fellowship then? Somebody's got to be wrong, and you know, one's right and one's wrong. And you know what I mean? I mean, we start creating all kinds of problems where there should be no problems. It's like, guys, you know, how about the idea that let's just relax, wait and see how it turns out, and present the best we can with the pieces that we have, and just wait and see. Why do you have to lock in and commit to anything? You don't have to. It hasn't happened yet, so let's not make it happen yet, because it hasn't. We got to wait and see. And I think that's one of the human things, is we want to have everything bag tagged, classified, cataloged, and we can't do that for things that haven't happened yet. So we have to just remain a certain amount of patience and wait and see. But have the flexibility to share each other's beliefs and just have a common idea. Okay, we just got to wait and see. You know, not trying to struggle at who's right and who's wrong. That's why I'm totally opposed to debating. Even the idea of a debate means it demands a winner and a loser. That creates an immediate hostile attitude and environment. I don't care what good intentions you have. It's going to end up getting personal. It's going to be ended up with name-calling or whatever, because one person has to win, one person has to lose. Now, I think the way God intended to have a correspondence like that is to have dialogue. Dialogue means I'm going to share the hope that's in me and explain why I believe what I believe, and then I'm going to give you an equal time to share the hope that's in you, why you believe what you believe. And then nobody wins, nobody loses. We allow the Lord, through the Holy Spirit, to speak to hearts who are listening or hearing, or ourselves, and let him verify and clarify what rings true and what ring doesn't. Now,
can I interject at this point?
You know, a person.
I love that perspective. May I interject on this?
You're going to want to win. And okay. I really think debating is a demonic game of the devil.
Amen.
If we have dialogue, that's where we learn. That's where we allow God to be God. And we probably find out that a lot of our differences aren't so different that they can actually have a compatibility to each other if we would be more patient to listen to each other and consider each other. Anyways, long story short, the meetings just, they started out with a lot of zeal and everybody was getting excited and thought this was great. And about 2 months later, nobody's showing up and people are getting attitudes at each other. And just we just got beat up and it was made... It was just torn apart. I was disappointed. I felt somehow I failed the Lord. I did have to look at myself being, you know, I am a type A personality. So, you know, I probably came on too strong and didn't realize that I was dealing, that my fellow brothers and sisters were the walking wounded. They had a lot of hurts and baggage that they hadn't addressed. And here I am coming in all assertive and trying to formulate this thing, and I think I did it a little overzealously, and they saw that as authority, power, trying to, you know, be in control of everything. I wasn't. My good intentions were misunderstood, but I think that was more me not realizing that I had to present things in a much different manner than I did.
Sure.
That's hindsight. You know, you learn from mistakes, and that was a mistake I made, but... Sure, go ahead.
Yeah. I just want to comment on what you said, and you know, Dr. Huntley, I'm going to let you weigh in a second here, since you're still with us. And for those
I'm still with you. I can't cut this loose. This is the most direct, and I would say most clinical approach I've heard in a long while. And I definitely want to make some input in regard to what you were saying about people addressing issues, and they had your feelings and your opinions. I believe the foundation should really be that it's not your opinion or my opinion, but God's word. Let's deal with the word, what the word says. And we cannot go into interpreting the word. We have to deal with the word from a revelation. I was very much impressed by the fact of what you had done, what you stood up to, and how you presented the issues. But I think, Daniel, it goes back to your reflection on sheep nations. You also touched on an issue that is very close to my heart, the unification of the church. There is one God. And then we should address this God and see him as he is, not as he appears to us, but see God as he is. And therefore we get unification. Where two or more on one accord, God's presence is felt. And I truly believe that if we take a chance to come together in one accord, there would be a tremendous change of shifting of the whole atmosphere would shift on Earth, the whole atmosphere, because we have a lot of people who are not well-grounded in the Word, and they adjust the Word to meet their needs, not adjusting themselves to meet the Word.
And let me just say this, because thank you for saying that. If you're listening to this live, call in 718-766-4160. I didn't make this very clear, but this last half hour of the program, I intend for this to be open call lines. In other words, weigh in. What's your experience? What do you want to say? Throw into the conversation here, because we're cracking this thing open. We're talking about it. 718-766-4160. We have about 15 minutes left. Now, going back to what, Jim, you were saying, I brought up that point and I wanted to ask you that question, because when you're dealing with the issue of wounded by leadership or just being wounded in general, you have those that have been wounded because they've been submitted to leaders, and then you have leaders that are fighting with other leaders, wounding on the same plane, so to speak, throwing arrows, throwing spears, slandering, coming against, and oftentimes it's because of undealt with bitterness, undealt with hurt, undealt with loss and issues of the heart, really, self-image, identity, that when people don't know who they are in Christ, they get confused and think that attacking others also in Christ is not attacking themselves. They don't understand we are actually part of one body, and so if you punch yourself enough times, you're going to get hurt. It doesn't matter if you're punching the left arm. You punch it enough time, the whole body hurts. And that's the thing. I really, this is my heartbeat. This is what I want to get across here, with why I'm addressing the whole issue of getting wounded in the first place, listeners. And it's just coming out. I'm not even bringing it up. It's just coming out. God has amazing things planned for his people. And he has given us so much to do it with. I mean, if you count up every promise in the Word of God and you actually brought all of them into manifestation at once, what would you have? You would literally have heaven on earth right here and right now. And the fastest way to bring in the provision, the promises, the power of God is through unity. And we can't unite if we're too busy attacking each other. Leaders too busy bullying their sheep. Leaders too busy sheltering themselves from other leaders, not allowing for the unity of the Spirit to have its right place in their lives, and ultimately moving towards the unity of the faith, which is described in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11. We're dealing with this because there's a bigger work on the horizon that we need to look at and say, wow, you know what? God, let's get on board with what you have, because how are you going to face some of the greatest evils history will ever reveal, which is what I firmly believe, and thank you, Jim, for bringing up all this stuff, because you know what? Honestly, listeners, if you have put the whole alien issue on the back burner, you said everyone's crazy, just wait. Just wait until God sends you somebody that says, I was abducted, and I'm still getting abducted. How are you going to help them? You're going to tell them they're making it up? They've already heard that. You cannot be used by God to help people if you refuse to believe reality. And you know, stop attacking. One, we need to get our perspective shifted on, let's do those things which are most productive, which are most lending to the hand of God being manifested through us. And if that requires us to change our belief and accept things we didn't want to believe in, so be it. Who cares? Once you begin to minister and see the power of God work because you were willing to believe that certain things exist, you will find God beginning to use you in greater and greater capacities. Why wouldn't you want that? Why are you going to attack my friend Jim here for trying to help you help others through the power of God? So we have to ask ourselves here, one, if we've been wounded by leadership, what is in the way of us allowing God to transform, and I'm kind of summarizing the program here, allowing God to transform that hurt, that wound, into gold refined in fire, silver refined in fire? What's standing in the way? Let's put that on the altar and let God's holy fire consume it. Let's be real. What are we afraid of? Why won't we let God deal with this area in our lives? It needs to happen. Just get over yourself. It needs to happen. You know, I want to throw this out here. Something, and you can weigh in on this, Jim and Lawrence, after I say this, was something that God has brought to my attention more recently, and I mean, at the beginning of this year, just slammed me with. He said, Daniel, you are afraid of the fathering ministry, and it needs to get out. You need to deal with this now. And I realized that as much forgiving as I had done and as much reconciling as I had done, I was not able to receive a father. I could receive a prophetic ministry. I could receive a teaching ministry. But I could not receive a fathering ministry. And the thing is, every culture that you look at in the earth, when you see the fathers getting systematically removed, that culture begins to crumble. And what wounding does in the body of Christ is remove people's ability, and mine, it definitely did it for me, I don't know about you guys, but definitely for me, removed my ability to receive fathering ministry because I was scared to death of fathering ministries. And moreover, those who have been called to fathering ministries cannot even walk into their calling and office because they're afraid of what God has put on the inside of them. And fathering ministries, the Bible says that God will send the spirit of Elijah before the great and coming terrible day of the Lord to unite the children to the fathers and the fathers to the children. God's last day plan literally hinges on the fathering ministry in the body of Christ. So one of the other things that I see dealing with wounds by leadership, bringing the body of Christ into, is the ability to begin to receive the kind of fathering ministry that is necessary for us to step up our game and become the kind of enemy and adversary to the works of the devil that we have been called to be.
Amen. Much you can add to that, man. That was summed it up beautiful. I mean, I think for us to take a step out to be, let's say, to be that. I know myself at 60. I've been following the Lord now for almost 40 years. I've been ordained as a minister for 37 years. So. In a sense, I should be a father in the faith, and I have, and I feel that I have been, and part of that is seeing and trying to nurture and encourage those that are have been doing this for a long time, or especially those that are just getting involved, to be there to be a source of encouragement, to provoke and promote people, to encourage them that they can spread their wings out and fly, that yes, you can be where you're supposed, you know, you are where you're supposed to be, you've been called, this is your calling, and you know, just in kind of taking people under your wing and leading them and guiding them to go on. And I think the best spirit of that is that we can't look at it as competition, and I think too many are looking at competition. We're like in a, I'm a fisherman. I do fish a lot. And so when you get an overpopulated lake or pond, you have a feeding frenzy. Everybody's struggling to make sure that they get what they need. So I see that almost the same thing in the sense that as more and more people are being added as researchers, investigators involved in this kind of thing, the opportunity to speak or to share what we have in a public venue anywhere is very restricted anyway. But now it's even getting tighter. There's more competition. So how are we going to handle that? How am I going to handle it? I started in 1978. I am one of the original pioneers. Whether I'm ever accepted for that or known for that or not, it doesn't matter. I am. How do I deal with that when I'm left behind? Do I look at it with regret, or do I look at it as, okay, Lord, where do I fit in from here? Well, I know one thing that I've always naturally done, and it's something that God has put in me. I've always encouraged those that are new to it to kind of give them some insight on some of the snares, try to encourage them that I've had several people now that are starting to write books that they didn't know for sure whether they could ever even write a book. And I said, listen, trust me, if I can, anybody on this earth can, if I can. So, you know, I've encouraged them and provoked them to love and good works, like the Bible tells us that we should be doing. I won't look at it as competition. I can't. The day I start doing that, Daniel, I've lost all sight of my ministry. I've lost all hope for a future for my ministry, because God's going to have to sit my butt down and revamp my whole brain. I have to look at it as teamwork. I have to look at it as, Lord, where do I fit in? What can I do to stand in the gap? Where's my place here? And at my age, I look at it. I got a weird way of and making analogies, probably because I'm too much of a sci-fi freak anyway. But you know, I remember as a young man, knowing that I was in the last days, and kind of after Star Wars came out, I'm thinking, wow, I'm one of the end time Jedi warriors. This is so cool, man. I'm going to be here for the, you know, when the Lord comes back and all this heavy duty stuff comes, and I'll be one of the warriors. Now at 60, almost 62, I'm looking back and I'm going, oh, I'm not one of the warriors, am I, Lord? I'm Yoda. I'm not one of the warriors. I get to train and help all the other guys that are going to be the warrior, because this is kind of going beyond my lifespan probably. And I'm good with that. That's cool.
Sure.
I got a teacher's heart, and I think
90 seconds.
The best thing a teacher can have is when he can instruct and prepare others to go even beyond what they've been able to go to. It doesn't get any better than that, I don't think.
Yeah. Well, we only have about 60 seconds left. Lawrence, if you wanted to say any last words before we close
out. Yes, it's very exciting to know that that we have warriors out here still, because somebody's got to beat the bush and stir up the enthusiasm. We do need, they said the harvest is great, but the laborers are few. And Christ said as he was leaving, he said there will be those who would come after him that shall do greater works. So we do have our work cut out for us, and what we have to do is raise up a generation of fishermen to go catch the fish.
Yeah, amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, folks, those of you that have been listening, this has been Discovering the Truth with Dan Duvall. We are out of time. Thank you so much for joining us. Next week we'll be back talking about Wounded by Leadership. Don't miss out on the conversations we're going to have this month, Tuesday, 7 o'clock p.m. Central Standard Time. Be there. We'll see you then. Good night, and God bless you.
And God bless.
10 seconds. Thank you for using Blog Talk Radio. Goodbye.
I had a dream. I was standing on the shore, 2 feet planted in the sand, soaking up your glory, yeah. Saw you all.